Good afternoon, everyone. I see the participant counter clicking upward. Jackie, let me know when you'd like me to open the meeting, if you would.
Sure. I will start with just a little housekeeping. So I will definitely pass the mic to you. Maybe just one or two, maybe just another minute or so, and then we'll get started.
Sounds good.
Thank you. Well, in interest of time, why don't we go ahead and get started? Good afternoon. It is my pleasure to kick off this second webinar of the Maternal Health Coordinating Committee's series on effectively partnering with communities in research to improve maternal health. My name is Jackie Wallace. I'm a fellow in the Pregnancy and Perinatology branch of NICHD. I'll be helping to facilitate the session. Feel free to introduce yourselves in the chat, note your organization. It would be great if we could facilitate some dialogue and some networking. And I would like to start with a few housekeeping points. If I may have the next slide, please. If you could make sure that your camera and your microphone are turned off, that would be helpful. We will be taking questions at the end of the session, but you could enter your questions into the chat box at any point throughout the presentations. During the question portion, if you would like to speak your question out loud, just raise your hand and we will unmute you. And may I have the next slide, please. It's now my pleasure to introduce Dr. Caroline Senior, who will start us off with welcoming remarks. Dr. Senior is a board certified obstetrician gynecologist who joined NIH in 2003 and currently serves as the deputy director of the Division of Extramural Research at the Eunice Kennedy Shriver National Institute of Child Health and Human Development here at the National Institutes of Health. Dr. Senior, I pass the microphone to you.
Thank you so much, Jackie. Good afternoon, welcome. And thank you to all of us, all of you for joining us for this important webinar. We are just thrilled to see the level of interest and registration, attendance, and participation with us from such a variety of individuals and organizations. It's just a real pleasure, and we're so grateful to have you join us. NICHD is really committed to community engagement when it comes to our support for research and discovery in improving maternal health and eliminating disparities in maternal health outcomes. It's really an honor for us today to hear from people with direct experience in this space, and I'm very grateful and I thank our panelists today for sharing their time and expertise with us. I also want to thank Dr. Wallace and the Maternal Health Coordinating Committee at NICHD for putting together this important webinar series and bringing it to us. I'm going to keep it very short so that we can have as much time as possible for exchange of ideas. So once again, thank you and welcome.
Thank you so much, Dr. Senior. May I have the next slide, please? It's now my pleasure to introduce our first speaker. Latasha Rouse is a birth and postpartum doula and owner of Birth Sisters Doula Services. Her journey as an advisor began 8 years ago after having triplets at 26 weeks gestation via an emergency vaginal delivery. Early on, Latasha's work was focused on bringing the parent perspective to the newborn intensive care unit and the antepartum improvement committee at Wake Med Health and Hospitals, including serving as a member of the NICU's Vermont Oxford Network team. Her passion is helping parents develop their voice in the care of their children and helping medical staff learn from and make improvements in care based on the parent perspective. Latasha has served as a subject matter expert and expert team member for the National Network of Perinatal Quality Collaboratives, the American Board of Pediatrics, the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists, the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services, and the National Quality Forum. Latasha's passion is finding ways for clinicians and patients to have a true partnership and improve outcomes. Ms. Rouse, I turn the mic over to you.
Thank you for that introduction. I am going to share my screen. And I'm here today to talk to you a little bit about recruiting. So in research and trying to find patient partners, where do you find them? That's the question, right? Everybody wants to know. So I'll tell you a little bit about where I partner and why. So in my background of having my children, I had triplets and they were at 26 weeks gestation. I also have an older child who was born at 36 weeks, two totally different experiences, but still traumatizing because having a 36 weeker, that was not expected. No one talked about that. And for that to happen, I had to work through some of the challenges of that trauma. And then with having the NICU stay of 4.5 months at the with the triplets, that was a whole nother set of things to deal with. So all of those things, my story of my older child, story of my younger children, and then my personal experience as a mother going through that, all shape the work that I like to do with organizations. So some of those organizations have been just wonderful partners across the country that I've been able to work with in different capacities. So some of it has been policy, some of it has been research, some of it has been at an organizational level. All of that has been different. The learning curves are very different. And so sometimes people think, oh, wow, if someone has done one aspect, they can do the other piece without any kind of orientation and prep work, not so. They're different. So the expectations of that mean that there's going to be a little bit of training. There's going to be some needs for explanation on the front end. And in research, I find that it is, where are we in this process? That is one of the things that you kind of starting into it. You're like, okay, you've been doing this for a year, or is this an idea? Like, where are we? What kind of changes can we make? And so in all of that work, the research that I have been able to work with is at Rutgers. So that was through the Maternal Child Health Research Network. And in that work, I started with them over a year ago, and I've been able to chair committees on equity and on patient engagement, where we work through what are we starting from the beginning? What are we going to focus on, and why is that important? And making sure everybody was at, you know, a point where that was a thing. I also was able to work with Berkeley, and that was centered around doulas. So that wasn't necessarily patient or children. It was what is the future of doula work in this country? Northwestern, that project is going to be around respectful care. And then one of my favorites, working with the University of North Carolina, that was like from the very beginning, the initial proposal, I was able to be a part of that process all the way into submission, and being able to bring in people, adding people to the team that I knew. And we'll talk about that as a recruitment option for you to work through, is as you bring people in, who do they know, who are in their network that they can bring in to help enrich this work. So who are we looking for? So before we know where to look, we got to know who we're looking for. We're looking for patient partners who are able to share their experiences in a way that people can learn from them. You're looking for people who can see a big picture. They're interested in more than one approach. So say you do start out and you think it's going to go one way, you bring a person in and now they're saying, well, you know, that part I didn't necessarily experience. Can they generalize enough to be able to still work on that project? Also, the ability to listen and hear other points of view that might be different. Everybody has to do that on a team, because it's often times going to happen. And then also thinking about, you know, the ability to make that connection, the connection between your point of view and my point of view, and how they can absolutely work together. The ability to speak up and be honest. That is one of the key things you need, because there are a lot of times when you will be working with patient partners and you will hear, they will hear something that just doesn't sit right, but not knowing if they can say it. Making them feel safe is a thing you need, but they also need to at some point take the leap and be able to say the thing that they're thinking. A sense of humor, things are not always going to go smoothly. This is a new thing for a lot of people. So there will be mistakes made, and being able to kind of roll with some of those things and have a sense of humor about them is important. And also, I love to make sure people remember that who you're selecting needs to represent the patient population or a segment of it that you are trying to study. So they need to be able to speak in terms of knowing that community as a part of that community in research, because a lot of times, especially with, people of color, you will, end up in a situation where you will see something that's it's different from my community. That's not how we do it. That's not how I would think about it. And so being able to have that representation is important. Okay. So where do we find them? Okay, so as I spoke about before, if you have current people that you have worked with, advisors, ask them about who they know that would be good for this, who maybe has had that experience or something similar. And not just advisors, also, you know, if you've done any of this work in the previous times, you might know other professionals that might be good for this. And so using the people that have already been a part of the work. Also asking other providers and nurses to help you identify patients and families that might be good for the upcoming project. A lot of times, providers and nurses keep in contact with patients and families that are close to them. And so that means that they could have, several people that they might be able to send your way to help with this research project. And then also reaching out to networks, support groups, community-based organizations. And in that, for maternal, I always say, don't forget your doulas. Don't forget the doulas in your community, the lactation counselors in your community. Don't forget your childbirth educators. All of those people that make up all of those professions know people. People know people. People need people, right? And so in that, being attached to a hospital can mean that you are able to connect to their televisions and be able to kind of put that on their screens to be able to kind of go through and show that there's this opportunity. A lot of people sitting around in hospitals, in waiting rooms, all of those are great places, even in providers' offices. Those are moments in time where people are waiting, captive audiences. Don't forget the bathrooms. A lot of times I find a lot of good opportunities and support groups even that you could also link to that would give you that that connecting point. So putting those flyers out would be a great way to think about it. So it can be flyers and posters, brochures. And then if there are patients experience surveys that the hospitals or that you work with have been able to gather, those surveys sometimes will help them to pull in patient partners. And if that is so, then those patient partners could also be good for research. Don't forget your website. A lot of times people do forget the website because it is something that, you know, it's there, but people don't remember to use it for that purpose. Putting it on the website as a way to recruit is a wonderful thing to utilize. And then that also means social media. Where most people live on social media, especially, you know, moms and families, they're on social media. Instagram seems to be getting more traction, but Facebook also has an opportunity within groups. And so if you are going to do that, make sure that you go into the group, find the admin, ask for permission. I actually got into a research project with Berkeley by responding to an ad they placed in a doula Facebook group. They put all the information and said, here's a link to apply. And I applied. So that is effective. And it's a way that you can reach a specific group of people because there's so many different groups out there that are specific to certain different demographics. And then remembering the key informants in the community around where you are. And those are people who are connected, well connected to the groups, who they know what groups are out there, what people are doing, what nonprofits are functioning, what their purposes are right now, what their focus is. And those key informants are wonderful ways to get several people that are really local to you. And then also finding key informants that might be in other states is also possible. So some of those people that you see over and over again, those are key informants. You might be able to find out, you know, connect with them and find ways to get other people. And then you're also looking at definitely still talking about that community. As you meet people, don't forget, especially when you're talking about people of color, you're looking for all kinds of ways. So definitely leaders, community leaders, church leaders, community health workers, all of the people that you run into contact doing this work are avenues to bring in patient partners and have them work on your research project. That means that you have so many different ways that everybody should have one, right? That's what we're working towards. All right, so I think that is the end of my portion. I have my contact information here. I'll pop it in the chat if you have any questions. I don't know if we're holding them to the end or we're gonna do them now. Let me know.
We will hold a question. We will have the questions at the end. Great, so thank you so much. Ms. Rouse, for a really important start to our discussion. A lot of nuggets in there that are really important. It's now my pleasure to introduce our second speaker. Miranda Clausen is the Executive Director of the Amniotic Fluid Embolism Foundation, which is a nonprofit advocacy and research organization that she founded in 2008 after surviving an AFE during the birth of her son. Miranda is also an investigator for the Amniotic Fluid Embolism Registry and Biorepository at the Perinatology Research Branch at the NIH. Ms. Clausen is a frequent speaker, panelist, and lecturer on amniotic fluid embolism and patient and family engagement. She has co-authored several papers, including the Support After Severe Maternal Event AIM Safety Bundle. Additionally, Miranda serves as the patient advocate for the California Maternal Quality Care Collaborative, the former Council of Patient Safety and Women's Healthcare at ACOG, the Institute for Perinatal Quality Improvement, and the National Obstetric Life Support Program. She's also a reviewer for the Pregnancy-Associated Mortality Review for the state of California, and is the co-founder of Mama's Voices, a national coalition of maternal health advocacy organizations. Ms. Clausen, I turn the microphone to you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Dr. Wallace. And thank you, Latasha. Let's go ahead and get started. Okay. I just want to say thank you to Dr. Senior and Dr. Wallace. And also thank you, Latasha, for kicking us off. I have no personal disclosures, no personal conflicts, but I would like to acknowledge Merck for Mothers and for their funding of Mama's Voices. So where do we get started? Here's a picture of me meeting my son for the first time. In 2008, I became a mom, by far the most important title I've ever held, and a title that I quickly learned can sometimes be met with supreme sacrifice. My birth was accompanied, or rather punctuated, by a rare, unexpected, and unpredictable complication known as an amniotic fluid embolism, or AFE. Our precious son was born emergently while clinicians worked feverishly to restart my heart and manage the complex bleeding issues brought on by the allergic-like reaction of an amniotic fluid embolism. AFE is most often fatal, and of those that survive, many will suffer severe neurologic impairment or have lasting health complications. AFE is also poorly understood. My doctors and nurses struggled to explain it to me, and its etiology has evaded researchers for nearly 100 years. In the days after being extubated and learning of more of what happened, my only thoughts were of our son and wondering how lucky we had been to both be alive. Those thoughts quickly evolved into action, and 3 months later, I laid the groundwork for the AFE Foundation, an organization entirely focused on reducing maternal and infant mortality and morbidity attributed to AFE through three key initiatives: support, education, and research. And I say here, it can start with really an N of one. And that's truly what's happened. And I hope to inspire those who are listening today that it really does start with just one person. The overwhelming driver of the AFE Foundation was to provide answers to the grieving families and affected patients. However, it became very apparent that those answers would be hard to come by without significant support from the research community. After combing through research articles and identifying the leading experts, I reached out to them with a small ask. Let me bring you lunch and share with you my ideas about a patient registry. I got an immediate response and an invitation to meet. A month later, I flew out and sat across from them and was met with empathy, interest, and respect. They believed in the idea and saw the value of working together. Over the last 13 years, those relationships have only deepened and resulted in some incredible accomplishments, most notably that I've been allowed to help design our research and its priorities. I'm here to share that, and I'm so excited to share that we have the largest database of AFE cases, most of which are a retrospective case review. Dr. Wallace shared, that we have a biorepository that we established with the PRB of the NIH. We've done 11 publications, of which I've been a co-author. We are the only active international registry and have developed some pretty significant diagnostic criteria. And while the title of mom is still the most important title I hold, I can say that now I can add author and investigator to those titles. But I'm certainly not alone in these efforts. In that first year of our organization, I was introduced to Dr. Roberto Romero, the chief of the perinatology research branch of the NIH. He too pledged his support for our efforts and said that I needed to meet another powerhouse, which was Eleni Segas, the executive director of the Preeclampsia Foundation. We were introduced, and I quickly recognized the value in mentorship and having a colleague in this space. Over the years, Eleni and I served on many of the same boards and working groups and shared some very similar concerns. There needed to be more advocacy groups and more patient family partners, especially those of diverse backgrounds, involved in advocacy, quality improvement, policy, and research. In 2017, the Preeclampsia Foundation spearheaded the revitalization of the maternal health bill that had stalled in Congress for years. Their efforts to rally support for the Preventing Maternal Death Act identified many other advocates who were assimilating into nonprofit organizations or online support groups. It was also through these efforts it became clear of the need to coalesce the energies of these advocacy efforts as we shared overarching issues, challenges, and opportunities. I'm happy to say that in 2018, the bill was signed into law, and Mama's Voices also was established through the generous support of Merck for Mothers. We are so proud to have representation from many organizations, groups, and individuals that are addressing the leading causes of maternal mortality and morbidity, as you can see here. And hopefully many of you have worked with these individual organizations already. So what is the purpose and vision of Mama's Voices? It really is pretty simple. It's to amplify patient and family voices, especially those who've been historically marginalized, ensuring they are equipped and activated as partners to improve maternal health outcomes. To ensure that Mama's Voices are engaged as partners wherever maternal health improvements are needed requires a very, very robust approach. It's a big ask. One example is hardwiring patient representation into all levels of maternal health improvement. We're so proud of the work that we've done with the Alliance for Innovation in Maternal Health and found a champion for patients in Christy Allen, the Senior Program Director. AIM now includes patient and family partners in all safety bundle development and revisions. We also identify and negotiate opportunities for patient representation. We're proud of the strong working relationships that we have with state PQCs, most notably in Texas and California. Mama's Voices also takes active engagement in engaging providers and stakeholders to create strategic partnerships. We've established mutually beneficial relationships with the Society for Maternal Fetal Medicine, the CDC, and the National Network of Perinatal Quality Collaboratives. But one of the most items that we're most proud of is our training programs to help those who, with lived experiences, become effective partners, and then matching them with the various opportunities, whether they be in research, quality improvement, media or speaking engagements, and connecting them with policymakers. So how now can that I've shared sort of what we do, how can we work together with all of you? I think the most important one is being receptive to research ideas and priorities from patients. And that was shown in just my own personal experience with the researchers of AFE and showing just how powerful it can be when they take the time to listen to what the needs of the patients or families could be. Becoming familiar with any relevant patient advocacy organizations or community-based organizations, as Latasha previously shared, that are in your area. Another way is if you're seeking patients for advisory council roles or focus groups to come to us. I'm sure that we have just the patient you might be looking for. Another thing is to consider testing the surveys and questionnaires through your research projects beforehand, before you broadly disseminate it and get that important feedback on the user experience. Also, consider establishing a champion who will onboard, facilitate communication, and provide knowledge translation with your patient, family representatives, or even your participants. This doesn't have to be the PI of your research. It could be someone on your research team. And I'm excited to share that we will have provider training for this very issue. You can also refer any existing patients to Mama's Voices for our advocacy training. And so if I can just take a brief moment to share with you about the training and the certification process that we offer. We have an online learning platform which addresses some of the key attributes in creating effective patient-family partners. The first is advocate readiness. We must recognize those that are coming to us, either for research projects or coming to organizations like Mama's Voices, have likely been significantly traumatized through a pregnancy or birth complication, or may even be grieving the loss of a loved one. So often, and even in my own case, when I shared with you, we jump straight to what can I do before we even realize, wait, have I even processed what just happened to me? This is a vital step in ensuring that an advocate is ready for any quality improvement or any research opportunities. I'd like to share just a brief example of one we had in our community. We had a researcher reach out to us from Stanford asking for a patient to share her more of a qualitative study, really looking at her experience and her prenatal care and then her birth experience and subsequently dealing with fertility loss after having a hysterectomy. And I noticed we had trained this advocate in our AAV community. She had gone through our training. I'd spent many hours with her on what types of projects she could be connected to. But I quickly saw that a qualitative study was going to be more than just answering a few simple questions and that she was going to have to revisit likely the most traumatic event that had occurred. She was also a woman of color, and I recognize that the current race relations and long-term weathering and everything that she had been through likely put her in a very high risk category for being triggered. And so we recognized that the value in her participation and actually paid for her to have EMDR therapy so that she could engage effectively, but also reduce the triggers that were sure to come by being involved in that study. We also help them learn how to share your story. As Latasha shared, it's important when you're looking for those characteristics of participants to know that they are truly not only ready, but that they can distill their story and sort of, while keeping in the genuine authenticity of the emotions, but sort of being able to participate without sort of evoking those same emotions. And so how can they share their story effectively? How can they distill it? We help them create a professional presence. We help them with media training. It's truly robust in what the certification process offers. We also offer continuing education for how to get involved in PQCs, MMRCs, how to effectively get involved with research, also on all the various AIM patient safety bundles and how can they help with implementation in their local hospitals. In addition to the online certification process, we also want to offer in-person opportunity to expand their knowledge and allow them to connect with others and share best practices with other advocates. Our Champions for Change Summit has welcomed over 400 unique patient and family advocates since our inception in 2018. And I will say firsthand by being at all of them, it is a powerful, powerful experience. So much so that we've actually had providers come so that they can get immersed in the patient experience. So as you can see here, there's opportunities to share and learn. We've have wonderful speakers that come and share, such as PCORI coming in to share how you can engage in research. And one of the things I'm most proud of is in the involvement is bringing in healthcare providers like Dr. Deering here down below who talked about simulation. And just by his involvement at Champions for Change and seeing the faces of the patients and the families that were impacted and how important simulation is in preparing for severe events, he quickly realized, wow, it could be much more powerful if we included patients in this opportunity. And so using real patient stories for the simulation, as well as even incorporating them into the simulation by inviting them to come in and share their experience with attendees. We actually just had our last summit this last weekend and had some incredible speakers. I think that we are well suited for future endeavors together. Another thing that's really important to share is just how we measure that we measure what matters. And in our community, we have a very strong understanding that sometimes not all the voices are at the table. And so we began measuring demographics in May so that we know who we're serving and who is missing to ensure that, again, everyone's voices are being heard. And lastly, this is Nicole Purnell. She's our program director. She is fantastic. She is happy to work with anyone to help in any way, whether in training or finding, imagining a patient. And I just look forward to answering any questions that you may have. And again, thank you for this incredible opportunity to share more about the AFE Foundation and Mama's Voices.
Great. Thank you so much, Ms. Clausen, for another terrific presentation. We really appreciate it. It is now my pleasure to introduce our final speaker, Dr. Ayanna Robinson. Dr. Robinson is a public health scientist and entrepreneur with over 10 years of experience in conducting research, program evaluation, and program planning, primarily at the federal level. Her dissertation research, published in Digital Health and Journal of Human Lactation, applied Black feminist theory to explore the experience and outcomes of Black mothers who participate in mom-to-mom breastfeeding support groups on Facebook. In 2016, she founded Black Girls Breastfeeding Club, LLC. Through BGBC, Dr. Robinson has participated in community events for mothers, discussions with college and high school students. She's partnered with other maternal health organizations like the Black Mamas Matter Alliance, and developed breastfeeding resources and educational tools for Black women. Decreasing the maternal morbidities and mortalities of and improving breastfeeding rates among Black mothers are the areas of public health that Dr. Robinson is most passionate about. In 2020, she launched BirthWork, an app that connects Black women and birthing individuals to online classes taught by Black birth workers and other health professionals. Dr. Robinson, I turn the floor to you.
Thank you so much for that introduction, and thank you to the previous presenters. I think much of what I'll share, my experience, particularly on one research project and engaging and developing relationships with community members in that process, I think will echo what Miranda and Latasha have shared in their presentations as well. So thank you both for those presentations. During this presentation, I will provide an overview of my research, particularly the study that I conducted as part of my dissertation for my PhD program. I'll describe ways to form engaged, equal community partnerships. I'll describe ways to bridge the gap between community voices and researchers, again, all based on my experience in this particular study. And then I'll discuss some additional challenges and other considerations. So I want to provide a bit of context to the study that I'm going to carry throughout the rest of the presentation. And I conducted a study that was published, as was mentioned, in Digital Health, also in Journal of Human Lactation in 2019, which examined the experience and outcomes of Black mothers who participate in Facebook support groups, particularly for breastfeeding support. And so I had three research questions, and those questions aimed to look at the experience of African-American mothers who are participating in these breastfeeding support groups on Facebook. I wanted to explore the types of breastfeeding support exchange within these groups. So typologies that include like informational support, appraisal support, emotional or instrumental or more tangible support. And then also, what are the outcomes, particularly as it relates to perceived support received online versus any breastfeeding support they had in person, breastfeeding attitudes. I looked at breastfeeding self-efficacy, their breastfeeding perceived norms, and also their intended breastfeeding duration. So the study was conducted again on Facebook, and participants were first-time mothers. They self-identified as African-American. They had to be currently breastfeeding and at least 18 years old. It was a sequential mixed method design, meaning that I conducted several phases of research, the quantitative portion first and the qualitative portion following the quantitative data collection. And so this just gives a little bit more background about what those phases look like. So initially, and in phase one, I conducted a survey online, had 29 questions. Again, that really got to some of those hard constructs that I was looking to measure, like perceived breastfeeding norms, perceived breastfeeding support, and so on. And in phase two was where I conducted my qualitative research. And so I conducted 4 online 60 to 90 minute focus groups. They were conducted on Zoom. They were smaller focus groups. They had 5 to 6 participants in each. And then I had a second phase of qualitative content analysis where I looked through the Facebook post groups over a 24-hour period and extracted those posts that were made and categorized the types of support that was exchanged and other themes within those discussions. My research used 2 theoretical frameworks, so Black feminist thought. And as I discussed these considerations for building relationships, engaging with community members, it's really influenced by this qualitative research framework, actually has implications for quantitative research as well, but Black feminist methodology. So the epistemology of Black feminist methodology, really how we think about generating knowledges, focuses on centering the voices of Black women as the criteria of meaning. It was also a framework that allowed me to look at elements of social activism within the breastfeeding experiences of the mothers who participated in my study, and also their intersectional experiences, Black women, but looking also at gender, at class, and other interlocking systems of oppression and how that related to their breastfeeding experience as well. The second model was more on my public health side. It's a theory I won't go into much detail, but it's very similar to the theory of perceived action, which is often used in public health research, particularly surrounding like breastfeeding research. So after I've provided you with just a bit of context for the study that I'm going to discuss, I can now shift into the ways in which I engaged community members and also the considerations that I took as I was aiming to collaborate with community members throughout my research process. So my first point is forming, engaging, and equal community partners. And here, I wanted to highlight the importance of leading with transparency and about your positionality as a researcher. So what I learned in my qualitative research studies was that we all have this subjectivity statement. As researchers, of course, we like to think that we are completely objective and we aim to be, of course, objective in the way we conduct our research, the way we analyze the research. But the subjectivity statement is essentially who you are as a researcher. We all have these different worldviews and experiences that really influence who we are. And these things can even influence why we are interested in certain topics. For example, I'm a mother, I'm a breastfeeding mother. Most of my early public health experiences in my world in public health was shaped by the fact that I was a pretty young breastfeeding mother. And so who you are is important. Why are you doing this work? When you are entering communities in an attempt to build relationships, I think that's important to lead with. I also think one of my lessons learned and something important to consider is your positionality as a researcher, specifically as an insider or an outsider. And this matters, especially when working with historically underserved or marginalized groups, for example, BIPOC communities, women, and LGBT communities as well. So another point that I wanted to highlight when thinking through engaged and equal community partnerships is the importance of building trusted relationships with individuals, including community members and also the gatekeepers. So as I've mentioned, my study was online, so it's a little different. It wasn't in a community in person, it's in a Facebook community, but it actually functioned a lot like a typical in-person community in that there were gatekeepers, there was a culture, there was specific language that they used, there were like rules and so on. And so one of my first steps in building the relationship was to identify the gatekeepers. In this case, the gatekeepers were the page administrators. And this was an important step in gaining trust reaching out to them allowed me to gain credibility within the online communities as well. And so I sent them messages online. I sent them a letter, emailed them a letter, I should say, about my study, explaining again, like my subjectivity, who I am, why am I interested in doing this work? And then the ask if I could engage their community in a research study. I think it was also important to provide autonomy when we're trying to create these equal community partners. And so one thing that was helpful for me is that I asked the admin their preference for introducing the study. For example, like, did they prefer if I posted about my study themselves or myself, or did they want to introduce the survey? And I found that when the administrators posted about the study and they introduced me to the community themselves, it really made a world of difference as far as increased visibility versus if I was to come into this community as an outsider and post, I think the results would have been a little bit different. I actually heard stories of other researchers who had just come into the communities, online communities, and posted about their research studies and asked for participants and was told that that wasn't really received well. And so they appreciated my process as well. And then as a final note, influence buy-in, I put a few comments. It's really interesting to see a study online. Usually if you're conducting an online survey, you don't really see any, you don't have engagement with the participants. It's often that cloud space of SurveyMonkey or Qualtrics. But I could see the buy-in and I could see that I was kind of accepted as an insider. They wrote lots of comments as they finished taking the survey. These are some of them. Good luck. I hope we can see the results, which is really important. I enjoyed taking the survey. I went to UGA. So there were some UGA appraisals. And then they also had an opportunity to ask questions about the survey as well, which was interesting. So now I want to switch to the next point. And one of the first points here is addressing power differentials. So power differentials, of course, exist between researchers and participants. Even with myself, I came into this group, I am a mom, I am a Black woman, but we're not a monolith. I am still representing academia. And so going back to my theoretical framework as a Black feminist thought, and feminist research focus groups help to ensure the voices of participants are the center and criteria of meaning. So that was one of the methodological considerations that I had after selecting this framework and knowing that this was something that I could use to attend to those power differentials. When conducting research with historically marginalized populations like women of color, for example, focus groups may also, again, balance those power differences between participants and the researcher while also creating the space so participants can create and develop culture together. So my next point in bridging the gap between community voices and researchers is really fostering collaboration and ensuring that you have these feedback loops. So one way to do this is sharing data collection tools with your community or with a group of stakeholders that represent the community and providing them the opportunity to review and also to provide feedback. So again, this leads to autonomy. Having the community or allowing the community to have some autonomy and ownership over the research process as well. And so for me, I shared the qualitative focus group guides. I also shared the surveys. I had conversations with the administrators about my research questions and what I hope to gain, but then I also asked them, as you review this survey, are there other topic areas that you're interested in learning about? Would you like to have any additional information collected so you can have information as well about these groups that you all have been running essentially for years? I should also say that the groups ranged in population size from 100 to 26,000 members at the time of data collection. And I believe the oldest group would start in about 2008. So again, there was a lot of opportunity for the researchers to get additional information, or not the researchers, for the administrators to get additional information as well. And then finally, creating feedback loops to share progress and also disseminate the findings. So prior to finalizing reports or manuscripts, allowing the participants to review the documents, I shared the draft manuscripts back to the participants. And then at the end of the project, it's important to share the findings back with the community as well. So presenting the findings back to the community, including exploring non-traditional ways to share the findings. One of the ways that I analyzed my dissertation data was using critical analysis and sharing that out with the community as well. So I want to end with just some considerations or even additional challenges as we work to build in better relationship processes with community members to ensure that we're honoring their voices. So one, I would say immediately, is time constraints. Research proposals and research projects can be under really tight time constraints. So considering how you're gonna build in time to develop those relationships and also to offer opportunities for feedback. So maybe you can't send your paper out and give participants a few weeks to read it. Maybe it will work better for you to just have like a roundtable presentation where you're presenting the findings, allowing participants to rank recommendations based on their priorities. Like those are other ideas. I think there are also IRB implications to consider. If you're sharing data collection tools out with participants and there are multiple changes based on feedback, that could have IRB implications. And then finally, it's worth asking and considering upfront, how and to what extent will you incorporate feedback? Because of course, when you're providing the opportunity for individuals to provide feedback, that opens up the space to get a lot of feedback, maybe feedback that you weren't expecting as well. So how are you going to deal with that feedback? That's important to consider as well. So I hope this presentation has provided some information, some jewels and some nuggets that you can use as you work to build relationships and to honor community voices. And I listed my contact information as well. Thank you all for this opportunity.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Robinson. Thank you so much for another really great presentation. Really, I'd like to thank again all of the presenters for your really thoughtful and thought-provoking presentations. Thank you so much for sharing your stories. I think this conversation is adding a really important element to the discussion about community-engaged research. I've attended quite a few events recently and heard some really interesting talk about community engagement, but today's presenters have really brought another level to the conversation. I think that considering the individual, those with lived experience and their families, it adds a really important layer, a bit of depth to the conversation, especially when we're considering the research question. So I'm so glad that we had a chance to explore that today during this webinar. But we do have now some time for questions. So if anyone would like to ask a question out loud, please raise your hand. We will go ahead and unmute you. And I would ask the presenters if they would come back and join me. Thank you. I am really not able to see the raised hands so well, so if I could get some help, Liz or Liza, if you could let me know if anyone is raising their hand, then we can unmute you. But if you don't want to speak and would just like to ask a question the old-fashioned way, you can go ahead and put that into the chat box and we will get to your question that way. And while folks are thinking about their questions, I can go ahead and jump in and start things off. So I'm very interested in how to best operationalize this engagement with organizations, but then also with individuals. And certainly I understand and we've heard from you that takes time, that engagement takes time, building partnerships takes time. But I wondered if you had any thoughts or suggestions about how we can best formalize is maybe not the best word, but how do we make this a regular, consistent process, a part of, especially in regards to developing the research question? Do you have any tips about how we might make this a little bit more of a ongoing, regular sort of event. So please.
I was going to say, if you are, you know, in a place where you're writing grants, always make sure that it's a part of your grant when you write it. But then also think about if you have the opportunity to bring someone on your staff to work on patient engagement, to have a person there. So maybe you have someone in the community who has done a bit of work and they could be on your staff so that in the development stage, you have that voice already there and you're not worried about, okay, we're not able to pay you yet. So we can't really utilize you until we get the funding. And then you miss the opportunity to have them work on developing that question, because it will change if you add that voice in. What people want to know is going to be slightly different.
I would echo that. And I would also just share that I think it comes down to funders as well, as making that part of the process of when people go for grants, is making that part of the application or the requirements.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. There's a comment in the chat about the importance of authentic relationships, which I think has really, I think all three presenters have brought that to the fore. And I think that's a really important part. So another question, how has COVID affected the ability to create partnerships and recruit now that our world is different?
Say it's gotten easier. You know, it has gotten easier because you have everybody is online most of the day now. So it's easier to contact people because everybody is now online. So the community in which you get to pull from, it's like a captive audience right now. There's so many more opportunities that I see going out. And I think people have more money to be able to pay people to do it, because you're not worried about in-person conferences and the expenses that go along with that. You're now able to take some of that money and redirect and use it in those ways.
Such a great point.
I would agree that it definitely makes it easier in a lot of ways. And my study actually was completely online and it was pre-COVID. So this was done before the pandemic. But the benefit of being able to access participants who weren't solely in Atlanta was very beneficial to me. And I've participated in other studies in the last year where we have recruited online and we've just been able to have participants from across the US rather than just in one geographic location. I think one consideration that we're always grappling with is like digital divide. So as we're moving more online, like, who are we leaving out? Individuals who don't have access to internet or smartphones. So those are all considerations. And I think we're all still figuring out the best ways to keep communities engaged who are without like technology that's needed to engage in online research studies. Like, how do we best reach those populations as well?
I would just add, if I could, that some of the ways that we've been challenged with COVID is just sort of layering the trauma. So we've found that those who are participating, at least in our studies, you know, anything tied to severe maternal events, you're sort of adding a pandemic trauma on top of many of our like new families have birthed in a pandemic. They've been largely alone without opportunities to have support from family members or community engagement. So I think that's been a little bit of a challenge, at least for those that connect to Mama's Voices, and most especially those in the AFE community, of just having the bandwidth to participate in research, even getting, you know, forms back or going through qualitative questioning and stuff like that.
Yeah, thank you. Those were both really great points. It is something that I thought a lot about, Dr. Robinson, about leaving people behind. And it's such a good point that I hadn't really thought about, Ms. Clausen, until I spoke with you about how important this support is to support people that we engage with. So let me get to another question. So what has been your experience and observations about the level of patient interest in contributing to publications or helping to develop maybe patient translation materials, et cetera? Is that an incentive? Would you feel that's an incentive that researchers could incorporate into their projects?
So I love that idea as incorporating it as an incentive. And that the incentivizing it hasn't been a part of any of the studies that I'm thinking about right now, at least that piece. We incentivize data collection, but I think that's a great idea to also support their intellectual contributions to finalizing the study. So I think that's great. I've had varying experiences. I will say that sending the paper out, I had less engagement that way. The more interactive in-person ways of presenting back findings before they were finalized have been a bit more engaging. So that may be a preference with the populations I was working with. For example, I've had in-person presentations where we shared findings and did very like interactive exercises to have them rank their recommendations before moving forward with the final report. And then I had a similar experience this past year where we did that same presentation, but we did it online due to COVID. And that was particularly engaging. So that's even a question that you could ask participants, I think. Would you all prefer that I send this paper out, you read through it and provide feedback that way? Or do you prefer like a presentation of some sort where we can have a conversation?
Thank you. That's great. And of course, I've totally lost track of time and we have run out of time. But I so appreciate having this discussion. Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts with us. Real big thank you to the NICHD team, the co-chairs of the Maternal Health Coordinating Committee, Drs. Nahida Chaktora and Juanita Chin, and all of the tech support, and can't thank everyone enough for bringing this together. We are recording this. The link will go out to the recording in about 2 to 3 weeks, and we look forward to continuing the conversation. So thank you so much, everybody, and have a great rest of your afternoon. Bye-bye.